get your communion cup? Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to worship this morning. It is great to be with you all. I am Renee. I'm the pastor here. Whether you're worshiping with us in person or online, we welcome you to River City this morning. We just have a couple of announcements before we begin. First of all, youth group meets tonight at 5:30 at the Browns Lane campus. We are at the Browns Lane campus this week at 5:30 for youth group. And also the 20-something small group will meet at 7 o'clock here this evening. So if you want to come back for the 20-something small group, they will be here. I think if the weather holds, there might be a campfire. But if it rains, obviously, we'll be inside. So if you want to join in on either one of those things, you are welcome. Our other small groups, our men's Bible study is taking a break for the summer, so that will start back up in the fall. Are there any other announcements that I missed that we can think of? Excellent. Well, I'm going to pray for us this morning, and then we will get started with our praise and worship. Loving and most gracious God, we thank you. We praise you for this day. We thank you just for the beauty of your creation that is around us. We thank you for the rain and the storms that came through last night. I do love a good summer thunderstorm, so we thank you just again for the wonders of your creation and the reminders of your majesty around us. And we pray now that as we come into this time of worship, we ask that your Holy Spirit would move among us, that you would open up our hearts and our minds to the word that you have for us this morning, and be with us as we sing your praises, Father. Remind us of who you are and remind us of who we are in your grace. It's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.
Will you stand and worship with me?
God of grace and God of glory, on thy people pour thy power. Crown thine ancient church's story, bring her bud to glorious flower. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage for the facing of this hour. Assail his ways from the fears that long have bound us. Free our hearts to faith and praise. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage for the living of these days. For the madness, bend our pride to thy control. Shame our want and selfish gladness, rich in things and poor in soul. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, lest we miss thy kingdom's goal. Lest we miss thy resignation to the evils we deplore. Let the search for thy salvation be our glory evermore. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, serving thee whom we adore. Thank you. we sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
He's worthy.
Song we could ever sing. He's worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. Prepare me to be a sanctuary.
If you would please remain standing and join with me in the Apostles' Creed this morning. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. I want to do something a little bit different before we go into our time of prayer this morning. I want to ask you guys, are there any prayer requests that you all have this morning that you want to lift up? I can get us started. I know you've never done this, or you haven't done this for a long time, at least, if you haven't done it before. So if you're a little gun shy, it's okay. But I'll get us started off. This morning, as Patrick and I were leaving, there were a couple of police officers outside of a house down the road from us. They were doing a wellness check. We didn't get to see how that turned out, but we're a little bit afraid that one of our neighbors may have passed away last night. Or sometime over the last couple days, his kids haven't been able to get a hold of him. So we just hope that that went okay, but we also just want to keep that family in prayer. Apparently they've had a couple of losses recently, just as we were talking to our neighbors this morning coming out. But are there any other prayer requests that you guys want to lift up for us to pray over this morning? Said, if you guys are a little gun shy, it's okay. I'm going to ask that you pray for the lead team. We're meeting for the first time together with me, at least, tomorrow, just to talk about some stuff for the upcoming year and some things that we want to see happen at River City. Any others? Yes, ma'am. Oh, I'm so sorry. If you didn't hear, his name is Mark and just lost his son to substance abuse. So we want to be sure to pray for Mark. Any others? Okay. All right. Well, we are going to spend some time in prayer together this morning. Loving and most gracious God, we come before you again this morning. And again, we are thankful. We're thankful for this time to be here as a church family, to praise you, and also to lift up all of those praises that we have. God, again, we are thankful just for the beauty of your creation. We are thankful for new life that has happened for some families We have a lot to be thankful for. We have birthdays coming up. We're so excited about those. And we just praise you and we thank you just for the gift of life and all of the celebrations that we have around us, Father. We have so many ways that we can be mindful and be thankful for the many ways that you have blessed us. And so we lift up all of those things to you this morning, just in praise and in thanksgiving of who you are. And Father, this morning we also bring with us all of those things that weigh us down, that are heavy on our hearts this morning, whether it be for ourselves, our friends, our family, those stresses and worries and cares that we lift up to you, that we just feel so helpless sometimes in these situations. And we just lift all of these folks up before you for your tender, loving care and mercy in their lives. We want to lift up Mark, just that in this time of grief, Father, that you would be close to him and his family. It's such just a tragic, tragic loss that they have suffered. And so we just pray for your love and your mercy and your grace and your peace to surround them in this time. We also pray for this family that lives down the street from us, that we just pray that wellness check went okay this morning. But whatever those circumstances, whatever those details are that we don't know right now, Father, we don't need to know them. We just lift up that family to you that has had a lot of loss recently. And so we just, again, pray that your hand would be with them, that your peace and your comfort would be around them in this time. We also lift up our lead team, that as we meet together tomorrow and we look for kind of coming out of COVID and putting some things back together and looking forward to our ministry over the coming year, God, I pray that you would be with that team and that you would help to lead us, that you would give us wisdom, that you would help us to be discerning of where it is that you're leading River City to be your people in the community around us. And so I just pray that you would bless the conversation, that you would bless that meeting tomorrow, that we might follow your will and your way and your direction for our church. Father, for all of the unspoken requests this morning, all of those things that remain the deepest cries of our hearts, God, whether it be for our family, our friends, or for ourselves, that we came seeking something this morning, God, we lift those up to you. And we pray for your help and your strength and just for those burdens to be lifted from our shoulders, Father. We are so thankful for the assurance that you have heard all of those things before we even ask and are ready to help us to bear these things. Father, we thank you, we praise you for who you are and again for who we are in your grace. And we pray all of these things in the words of the prayer which you have taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, and thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Do we have any kiddos this morning? I don't think we have any Splash Worship age kiddos this morning. Harrison decided to stay at home today. We're gonna get him. All right. Come on. There we go. Our scripture for this morning comes from John chapter 17, verses 20 through 26. Again, for any of you who want to follow along, it's going to be on the screen as well, but if you want to follow along with your Bible, it is John chapter 17, verses 20 through 26. These are the words of Jesus. I'm not praying only for them, but also for those who believe in me because of their word. I pray they will be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. I pray that they also will be in us so that the world will believe that you sent me. I've given them the glory that you gave me so that they can be one just as we are one. I am in them and you are in me so that they will be made perfectly one. Then the world will know that you sent me and that you have loved them just as you love me. Father, I want those you gave me to be with me where I am. Then they can see my glory, which you gave me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, even the world didn't know you, but I've known you, and these believers know that you sent me. I've made your name known to them and will continue to make it known so that your love for me will be in them and I myself will be in them. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So there's a movie called The Prestige, which came out in 2006. It's an underrated movie, but it's pretty good. It stars Christian Bale, Hugh Jackman, and Scarlett Johansson, and it's about competing magicians. They're trying to be the absolute best at their craft. And at one point, one of them is demonstrating a new magic trick to their assistant that is sure to just leave the crowd in awe. And the assistant says in wonder at the seamless execution of this illusion, "But it's so simple. How can something that simple be so amazing?" And the magician replies, "Simple, maybe, but not easy. Simple, maybe, but not easy." That might be our mantra as we start on a new series for the next 5 weeks. From the beginning of things, Christians who are trying their best to live their lives in accordance with the ordinances of God have been asking, "What is it that I have to do? I need concrete examples. What do I have to do? If this discipleship thing is a daily life thing, what does this mean in the minutiae, in the everyday boring things of life? What does this mean as a spouse, as a child, as a student, as a boss? What does it mean?" Discipleship seems simple. Love God, love people, and follow Christ. But it is not easy to figure out exactly how to do that each and every day. If it brings you comfort, this is something that people have asked from the very beginning. What can I do to set me apart as a child of God? The covenant, the laws, all of that was to make people distinct as God's people. We could look to Jesus' ministry of the wealthy man who comes up to him and says, "I follow the law, I'm righteous, but what else do I do so that I might inherit eternal life?" The apostles asked Jesus, "What do you need from us? How can we be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? What do I need to do?" Tax collectors ask how they can be reconciled with God. Pharisees ask questions about what Jesus expects from people who are trying to live under the law. It is a common question from people who are seeking to live a Christian life, and we have been asking it from the very beginning. So we're going to try and tackle this question together by looking back into our tradition as Methodists. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, gave the home groups meeting under this movement three simple rules to follow. This is how they checked in with one another and they talked to each other about their spiritual discipline and growth. "If you can keep these rules to the best of your ability," he told them, "you will be pretty much on the right track to doing God's will in the world around you." They are simple to remember, but they are not necessarily easy to follow. But they can give us a good concrete foundation to build on as we look for ways to practice them in our daily lives. He told his home churches, there are three main things that you do to try and live within God's will. First, do no harm. Second, do good. And third, stay in love with God. Or if you want the 1700s John Wesley language, it was attend upon the ordinances of God, if you want to sound fancy. But do no harm, do good, and stay in love with God. Simple, yes, but not easy. So we're going to do a quick overview of each of these rules to help orient us for the discussions that we're going to have over the next few weeks. Again, these seem very simple on the surface. Obviously, we're trying our best not to hurt people, to do good for people, and to be in love with God. Like, this is kindergarten level stuff, Pastor. Come on. But when we really dig in and we look at the depth of what exactly this means, that we are talking about trying our best to harm absolutely no one, to do good for absolutely everyone, and to stay in love with God all of the time, we can see where it would get quickly overwhelming. So the first rule, do no harm. The question people would be asked in those early Methodist meetings was, are you doing no harm by avoiding evil of every kind, especially that which is most generally practiced? In short, just because everybody else is doing it doesn't necessarily mean it's a good idea. avoiding evil of every kind is kind of the real kick in the teeth there. What does that mean? What do we count as evil? What are we told about the things that count here? We could start maybe by thinking about the Ten Commandments. We're not murdering people. Excellent. That's easy. We're not lying, right? Maybe some of us could use a little bit of work on that one. The discussion about little white lies or feeling obligated to lie to be polite to people, that's a discussion for another day, maybe. But we should strive to be honest people. I think we can get on board with that. But what about the smaller scale stuff, though? It's also very easy, I think, to follow this rule with people that we like. They get very much harder when we do not get along with the people that we are interacting with. There's a small group study book on these three rules written by Bishop Reuben Job. And on the rule of do no harm, he writes, "If I am to do no harm, I can no longer gossip about the conflict I am involved in. I can no longer speak disparagingly about those involved in the conflict. I can no longer manipulate the facts of the conflict. I can no longer diminish those who do not agree with me and must honor each as a child of God. I will guard my lips, my mind, and my heart so that my language will not disparage, injure, or wound another child of God. I will guard my lips, my mind, and my heart so that my language will not disparage, injure, or wound another child of God. This rule sits on the idea that we will never look into the eyes of someone God does not love. Everyone is a beloved child of God. Everyone is pursued by God with the promise of transformative grace." Now, this only talks about our actions toward other people that we interact with. We haven't even gotten into what this means for our interactions with creation, toward people like those in authority. There's a lot to the idea of trying not to do harm in any way. It is a simple rule, but it is not necessarily an easy one. We're going to try not to go too far down the rabbit hole on that one just yet, because we've got two more rules to get through. The second one is to do good. Now, at very first glance, it can seem like this is very similar to the first rule. If we are not harming, clearly we're doing good, right? Not necessarily. I think there's one crucial difference between the two. Doing no harm is about looking at things that we may currently be doing or that we may feel inclined to do in a situation and asking for the strength and power through the Holy Spirit to no longer do that. It's very reactive. We may want to scream at the person who cuts us off in traffic, but we stop ourselves from doing it. Doing good is more about being proactive, to look for the opportunities where we can joyfully demonstrate the love of Christ to those around us. In Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14, Paul says, "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity." The rule of doing good is just that, to be compassionate, kind, humble, gentle, and patient. To be those things, to embody them, and to live them out in the world around us. So how do we do these things? How do we remain attentive and aware of the harm that we might be doing? How do we stay on the lookout for the ways and the places in which we can do good? We do it by following the third rule, which is to attend on the ordinances of God, or to stay in love with God, or to work on your relationship with God. To attend on the ordinances of God just means that we participate in the marks of a Christian life. John Wesley called these the means of grace, or the ways that we experience grace in our lives. These are things like worship, prayer, study, reading scripture, partaking in the sacraments, as well as participating in acts of mercy and kindness for others. This rule is just about being active and attentive to your spiritual life, making the time to be close to God, leaving the space for His grace to work in your life, and asking for the strength and the wisdom to be able to know His will and be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. So that's it. Do no harm, do good, stay in love with God. These are meant to be the synopsis of a Christian way of life. They are meant to be a very practical way of looking at Christian living. Concrete examples of what it means to love God and love others. And in a really beautiful way, they also give us as Christians something to unify behind. Now, when we hear words like unity and we talk about not harming people, we tend to think this means that we aren't allowed to disagree on things. And if we do disagree with people, somehow that means that we're doing something wrong. That's not what this means. We are going to disagree with each other sometimes. It's just gonna happen. We are not going to like everyone on the planet 100% of the time. You're not doing it wrong. It's okay. Sometimes we're just not going to see eye to eye on the best way to do things. But what these rules do is they change the way that we approach conflict. If we can remember that we will never encounter someone that is not beloved by God, even if they are not yet aware of how much God loves them, we approach our disagreements differently. And when conflicts arise in the church, if we can agree that we are all trying our best not to harm others, to do good, and to stay in love with God, that can be a path to common ground with those who believe very differently from us. We can approach conflict differently and might be able to bless each other instead of cursing each other when we cannot come to a common consensus. These rules can lead us to a place of unity as people and as disciples. Not that we always get along, but that we recognize that we are all trying to do our best to live a Christ-like life and to walk together in Christian love. Committing to this way of living is hard. It's not easy. It sounds like it should be easy, but because these are not, on the surface, difficult ideas. But living them, very different kettle of fish. In a way, these rules are the ultimate guide to what it means to surrender to God's grace and power in our lives. To do no harm is to invite God into the places where we may feel our weakest and show His strength in the places where we feel like we have none. To do good is to invite God to be at the forefront of the places where His love and grace can shine the brightest. To be an agent of grace, to demonstrate and show others not our love for them, but God's. There's a song by Brandon Heath that came out several years back called Give Me Your Eyes, and the chorus goes, "Give me your eyes for just one second, give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing, give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see." To do good is to surrender to God's point of view on the world. And to be so filled by love and compassion for these beloved people of God that we cannot help but be extravagant in kindness and love towards others. To stay in love with God is to surrender to the fact that we are not perfect and can only be made perfect through the sanctifying grace of God. And the way to do that is to make the decision each and every day to be in relationship with God. Approach this the way we do all of our relationships. We work on our friendships, our relationships with parents and children, our marriages. We put in the effort. Relationships are like living things. They're growing and they're changing because we are always learning about each other. And we're learning more about ourselves through those relationships. And the same is true with God. We will always have something to learn about the way God is working in the world, and we will always learn more about how we can be more and more Christ-like in our words and actions. Now, the big drawback to these rules, if you're hearing them for the first time and starting to look for places in which to start living them out, is that it can be like drinking from a fire hose. do no harm. Well, what counts as harm? Talking badly about people, thinking badly about people? Are we talking about harm to people, to the environment, to animals, to ourselves? Like, what actually counts as harmful? It's a lot. What about doing good? Does that mean I have to be out doing something all of the time? What if I want to stay home and not talk to people once in a while? And what about staying in love with God? How many times a day should I be praying? Is 30 minutes enough for a real devotion? How do I know that I'm doing this right? It's very easy to get very overwhelmed by this. Again, this is why they're simple rules, but not easy ones. I'm not going to leave you floundering out there on your own with this. Don't worry. The rest of this series, what we're going to be doing is we're going to apply this to different areas in our lives. So this week is the overview. We will start looking at what we do with these rules in our public lives on social media, our personal lives and our relationships, our spiritual lives within the church, and the most personal life of how we treat ourselves. There will also be a small group study starting the week of July the 25th based on that book that I referenced earlier by Bishop Job. And it's going to give us some time to talk about these in even more depth and think through ways that we can live these out together. Those groups are going to go on for about 6 weeks. We will have two sections across campuses, one led by Pastor Adam and one led by me. If you're interested in being in one of those sections, I have a sign up. We're going to pick days and times once we see who all is interested and what availability looks like for everyone. This will be hybrid, so there will be an in-person section. There will also be a Zoom option. So for those of you that are meeting with us online, don't worry. There's a way for you to join in with these small groups as well online. I said it the first week, and I will say again that I am a practical person. I want to be able to give you some tangible things to hold on to for what it actually means to be like Jesus in your daily walk. So as we go through these next several weeks together, let's work on these things together, because I've got some growth to do as well, so you're not alone. So as we get ready to go into our time of communion this morning, what this is a reminder of the very foundational knowledge of God's love for us, that he sent his Son, that whosoever believes in him shall never die, but have everlasting life. For Christ did not come into the world to condemn the world, but so that the world might be saved through him. If anybody did not get a communion cup, just kind of wave, and we will make sure that one gets to you. Oh, you all did so good this morning. Look at you all. All right. So again, we're going to go through our short liturgy together, and then I'll prompt us to take this together at the end. So just hold on to this for just a second. But as we prepare to take communion, we are reminded that Christ invites to his table all of those who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and who seek to live in peace with one another. And we're reminded that on the night that Christ gave himself up for us, he had a meal with his friends. And at that meal, he took bread and he blessed it and he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this and remember me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, blessed it, gave it to the disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of a new covenant. And it's been poured out for you, and it has been poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. So do this as often as you drink it and remember me." Let's pray together. Holy God, we pray this morning that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on each and every one of us that have gathered here and on these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine. And we pray that they would be for us this morning the body and blood of Christ, so that we might be for the world the body of Christ, those who are redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ. Make us one with each other, so that we might be one in ministry to all of this world, until Christ comes again in final victory and we feast together at his heavenly banquet. It is through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit and your holy church that all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. So go ahead and get that plastic seal and get your wafer. There are two seals on these if you've never encountered these before. All right. This is the body of Christ that was broken for you. Receive this gift of grace. And then go ahead and get your second seal with your juice. The blood of Christ poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Receive this gift of grace.
Sing this with me.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. My heart. Oh, here.
So again, if you would like to sign up for the small group study that's going to be starting at the end of July, please let me know. Also, if you are a first-time visitor with us this morning, we have a gift for you out front that I would love to give you and just meet with you for a second and welcome you to River City with us this morning. But I want to leave you with our usual with our usual benediction, our weekly blessing, a reminder that the love of God, it is with you. And the grace that's been poured out on us through his Son, Jesus Christ, it is sufficient, it is enough. And the power of his Spirit is with you, and it goes before you as you leave from here. So go in the love, the grace, the power, and the peace of God.